Jones F. Feninga Theater and the Center for Civic Engagement on the UW Marathon County Campus for the 2016 City of Wausau Mayoral Debate. I'm Glen Moberg of Wisconsin Public Radio. Our panelists are Nora Hurdle of USA Today, Network Wisconsin, and the Wausau Daily Herald, Mark McPherson of WAOW-TV Newsline 9, and Sean Caldwell of WSAW-TV 7. Please welcome our candidates, Jake Kronenwetter and Robert Mielke. Our format, each panelist will pose a question to both candidates who will have up to 90 seconds to answer. After both answers, the same panelist will ask a follow-up question as an introduction to a free-form open discussion period between the candidates lasting between 3 and 5 minutes at my discretion. During the open discussion period, candidates are free to elaborate on their previous answers and to question each other directly. The order of responses will change with each question. There are 1 minute opening statements and 1 minute closing statements, with the order determined by the flip of a coin. Wisconsin Public Radio has strict rules about all of the debates we sponsor. Only candidates whose names are specifically listed on the ballot can participate. Now, we want this to be a thought-provoking, issue-oriented forum. The candidates understand that they will refrain from personal attacks, and disruptions from members of the audience will not be tolerated and will lead to ejection from the theater. It's time now for our 1 minute opening statements, and as determined by the toss of a coin, Robert Mielke has 1 minute.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Robert Mielke, and I'm running for mayor of Wausau. Many have asked why I want to be our next mayor. The simple answer is this: I love Wausau, and I want it to succeed in a positive, forward manner. Wausau's at a crossroads, and we have an opportunity to use this election to move away from a decade of business as usual and toward exciting new things. We have great potential for growth in jobs and tax base as our economy recovers. Seizing the opportunities will demand leadership and team building with a professional approach. I bring these skills to the table with the experience I've gained on the City Council and as a council president. Since 2012, I have learned what works and what does not work in local government. The mistakes of the past were rooted in unclear leadership and poor communication. As mayor, I will make sure all communications with my management team are clear and that the goals and objectives are met. Wausau must grow tax base by creating an environment that attracts new businesses and encourages expansion of existing ones. This will create employment opportunities for all workforce levels. Our city needs to create more positive outcomes. A mayor who promotes Wausau and manages City Hall well can create new positive outcomes and expand upon the successes that we have had. I will be that mayor. I can bring people together to solve problems and work toward progress within City Hall with neighboring communities. It is a key goal of mine to move Wausau in a positive direction by rebuilding trust between the mayor's office, City Council, and the residents in an open and transparent way.
And the minute is up. Jake Kronenwetter, you have 1 minute.
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. Thank you so much for coming tonight. My name is Jake Kronenwetter. I'm a lawyer here in town, born and raised on the southeast side of Wausau. Went to school in some fine cities, Pittsburgh and San Francisco. Ultimately graduated from the law school down in Madison and came back home to open up my practice. And, with a one-year hiatus at a small law firm in Antigo, I've been practicing in Wausau here representing my friends and neighbors ever since. I got into the race for mayor here because for too long our city hall has been disconnected from the interests of most of the residents. For too long our tax base has been shrinking, our tax rates have been increasing, and the services provided by City Hall have been dwindling. Now I hope to reverse all of those trends, primarily by restoring the decision-making authority in City Hall to all of you, to the people of Wausau, and not small groups of special interests.
And we go for our first question to Nora Hurdle of the Wausau Daily Herald. Nora?
As mayor, you will inherit the ongoing fallout from a November incident between a city council member and a senior city staffer. That includes an outside investigation, 2 staff grievances, and the threat of litigation. How will you manage this and keep it from happening again?
Jake Kronenwetter, you have 90 seconds, and then Bob Mielke.
Well, the 2 grievances are really, in my mind, the only significant issues remaining here. We have complaints from city employees, and those need to be addressed through the grievance process. Beyond that, I think that most of the residents of this city, myself included, are sick to death about hearing about these spats between councilmen and councilmen and employees and various folks in City Hall. I expect that when the grievances have run their course, when determinations have been made, that'll be the end of that story. Assuming that we don't elect one of the key figures in the food fight as our next mayor. If I am trusted as the next mayor, I will avoid these problems in the future by implementing an inclusive attitude in City Hall, a respectful attitude in City Hall. Now, I've been at many of these council meetings in the past few months, and it is amazing to me how city staff members can be dismissive and sarcastic to council members' questions. They can engage in joke making or scoring points rather than answering those questions. I expect if you trust me as the next chief executive in City Hall, my employees will have a little more respect for their bosses.
Bob Mielke, you have 90 seconds.
Thank you. Well, for 7 months beforehand, I did have the council, I did have city staff and everybody moving in the right direction as far as a civil, respectful way. Unfortunately, there was one incident that will be resolved quickly here, pretty soon. What I would want to continue to do, I was fortunate enough to be told by other city staff, other council members, that I did have it going in the right direction. And no matter what happens, we do have to have a civil, respectful discourse, if you want to call it that, as far as having a good, healthy debate, but to do it in a respectful way where grudges are not held. I will continue that as far as what I did when I first started for the first 7 months when I was president. As it is, I do believe that change is coming and that change will be good. We will not have the drama and dysfunction that we've had in the past. And I think we can move forward in a positive way, and we've already started doing that.
And Nora, you've got a follow-up question.
Wausau's recent mayors, John Robinson, John Hess, Jim Schaefer, Linda Lawrence, and Jim Temple, all had different management styles. What is your management style, and how can you use it to restore a friendly and functional working environment for city employees?
Now, this is a 3 to 5 minute open discussion period. Whoever wants to go first.
I guess what I would be end up doing is just what I've done before. I'm known as being very respectful, very open-minded. I work well with others. I do have that civil, where I can get along with anybody. And I've been able to get that, build that consensus, if you will, as far as having folks come together. And that's something that we need to get back and get going like we had once before. My style of approach of management is a hands-on. I will not be a hands-off type of leader. I will not be a micromanager, but you know, I want folks to realize that there's expectations at City Hall and there's accountability as well. And that has already been shown. Not to do it in a micromanaging type of way, but to bring everybody together to work for one another. And I'm known as a uniter. And believe it or not, that's already been shown. And that's my management style, and that's how I would end up trying to continue on.
I've said many times during the course of this campaign that we need a culture change in City Hall. And that takes some top-down leadership. That takes clear expectations being laid out by the executive. And it takes buy-in from city employees. And I question whether the existing city leadership can be trusted to unite staff and bring them together. In fact, I don't question it. I think the answer is no. I think the answer is clearly no. The man seated to my left has been the president of our council during the period where things have descended into a food fight. And just assurances that he's a uniter don't ring true when we can all see the evidence of his leadership. Now, obviously, as an outsider, as someone who hasn't been on city council, I'm asking you to do the same thing that my opponent is and trust that my leadership style will be received by the employees at City Hall well and that I can work with people. I come from a background as a litigator, where day in and day out, I'm arguing with people. I am fighting with them on some very serious issues, very life-changing issues. And throughout, I think if you ask colleagues, if you ask others that you know, are on the other side of these cases, they will tell you, I can fight, I can be on the opposite side of an issue with someone, and still that will not prevent me from working with them in the future and remaining civil with them. That will inform my management style. Just because issues are terribly important and we have to go to the mat on them, doesn't mean that we're not ultimately on the same team running our city together.
Bob Mielke, do you have a response as one of the participants in the food fight, according
to Mr. Kronenwetter? Well, yes, I do. You know, unfortunately, there was one incident, and unfortunately, sometimes in life, you cannot work with everybody. I think it has shown that I've been more than fair in trying to work with this individual, as have others. Unfortunately, you know, this incident did happen, but understand where I'm coming from in regards to what happened. I had to protect a city employee who filed a work grievance. I had to protect the city itself from liability because of this incident. And actually, I had to kind of protect a council member because this was not a first-time incident where this had happened before. I'm still trying to be fair and decent and civil to everybody. I think everybody will tell you that. I do have that ability to reach out and work well with others. This was an isolated incident, unfortunately. I wish it hadn't happened, but just the same, I would do it again for the same situation in protecting people. I still have that ability to try to get folks to come together, to build a consensus and do what's good for the citizens of Wausau. You're never going to please everybody is what it boils down to. And unfortunately, one member has caused some drama and dysfunction. The good news is that this next election, no matter who is in there, I think a lot of that drama and the dysfunction will be gone.
All right, we're going to move on to Mark McPherson with the next question.
I'd like to talk about the Wausau Center Mall. Mr. Mielke, you voted against the $4.1 million loan for the mall. Mr. Kronenwetter, you said you have strongly opposed it. Now that that money's through, do you support CBL's vision for the mall? And do you think the mall would have died without that loan?
I believe the mall would have died. I was not anti-mall per se. I just did not like the fact that they only brought one option. There should have been a plan B, a plan C. And I know I'm going to get nailed from my opponent as far as that I had brought it forward for discussion. It was a unanimous vote where everybody did bring it forward for discussion, but I was opposed to it. I don't think government should be involved as far as supporting private business. However, it got passed by the City Council. At this point, we have to make it work because it's taxpayer funds. CBL will be held accountable as far as monthly discussions and that vision that they have before phase two, phase three moves on. The one thing that I really hope that happens for the building process, I hope CBL will hire local labor and contractors. If for any other reason, because those individuals are helping pay for it as well. So at this point, we do have to see it through and make sure that it works. And if it doesn't, CBL will be held accountable. I voted against it simply for the fact there should have been more options brought to the table.
And Jay Kronenwetter, you've got 90 seconds.
Thank you. Of course, Mr. Mielke does ignore his two votes to move the project forward, as he says, or at least doesn't really explain why the votes at council were so different from the votes at full committee, vice versa. When he voted to move the mall loan forward, it was clear that it was a 2% loan over 20 years, that it was $4 million going to CBL for the purpose of moving Yonkers. And that was in the documentation presented at committee, and it was voted on, and Mr. Mielke voted yes. And to say he wanted more options now is a little, I mean, I'd say surprising, except he's been repeating this point since he voted against the mall loan at council. But he was the president of city council while all of this planning was going on. He, outside of perhaps our mayor, had the most authority and the most responsibility to come up with other options if he didn't like the one that he voted for. And to sit here now and say, hey, I wish there were more options, I think demonstrates his lack of leadership on these complex issues. I think this is clearly why we need a new leader in City Hall.
And let's move to Mark McPherson with a follow-up question. Mark?
Question, but Mr. Mielke, you look like you wanted to respond to what Mr. Kronenwetter said.
Yeah, I don't think that was a very fair statement, to be very honest. There's nothing I could do about it. I would ask him, what would be your option? What would you have done to bring forward? You're listening to your economic and community development committees as far as what they wanted to have done. You're listening to CBL. What would you have suggested?
Well, if we were looking at a $12 million investment to increase traffic in the mall, which is what this project is, mind you. Phase one is $4 million. Phase two in this plan is an additional $8 million for renovations in the mall. Now, if we were looking at investing that amount of money in increasing traffic downtown, I would have been looking toward an arena and convention center. I would have been looking toward other development projects, not managed by CBL perhaps, but that would bring traffic downtown. Now, as far back as Mayor Hess, we were looking at options for an arena and convention center, and then those were shelved. Under Linda Lawrence's leadership, we were looking again at an arena, this time closer to the riverfront project development, closer, a little further north along the river. And, you know, proposals were put forward, ideas were kicked around by some local architects, basically donating their time. And here we are 10 to 15 years later, and no action has been taken on this arena and convention center concept. Now, that's one option we could have explored with such a significant investment. Instead, we have voted forward a multi-phase plan which requires not only the $4 million recently spent and bonded for, but additional $8 million for phase two, an undisclosed amount for phase three. And then, by the way, we're looking at investing another $11 million in the parking ramp at the mall. You know, the total package that was just voted on is closer to $20 million than four. And I expect that if you want more options for downtown development, different options for downtown development, you have to change the people involved in your city leadership. And we can develop other options.
That was part of my follow-up, is where do you see the mall going in the next 20 years? Do you see more of a retail space, different use for that space, maybe 3rd Street going through the mall? That's one of the options. And if the mall does go under, what does that mean for downtown?
Well, we can't have the mall go down. I think it would create a ripple effect as far as the loss of jobs and down 3rd Street, that type of thing. I see it possibly being opened up. I don't see a big retail setting. You know, people can get stuff. It's a different world as far as retail today. People, Amazon, ordering off the internet. I would probably say that, you know, an entertainment center, be it a theater, maybe something that Jay had talked about as far as a convention center, perhaps. That's been talked about and bannered about for years, but there doesn't seem to be a lot of interest in that. It would have happened beforehand. But as far as, we've got to make it work because those public funds are in there. And then, like I said, holding CBL accountable as far as how that money is spent. And before the phase two and the phase three and the parking ramp and everything moves forward, that they've got to adhere to what they said they would do as far as phase one.
Jay, let's hear your vision for the future of the mall very quickly, then we have to move on.
Well, ultimately, you know, the future of the mall in the near term is in the hands of CBL. They are, in fact, the mall manager. And, you know, what the city wants to see happen with the mall property itself is not the determinant factor here. CBL needs to start doing its job. If anyone from CBL is listening, you can start by getting some cakes in your urinals and making sure that the hallway outside the bathrooms doesn't reek. If you can't tell, I don't believe CBL has been that solid of a partner for the city of Wausau. And I expect if the mall is having too much more difficulty staying viable as a retail operation, the first step will be finding someone to manage the mall who's committed to the city of Wausau and replacing CBL.
Let's move to Sean Caldwell with the next question. Sean?
In terms of government structure, do you believe that Wausau should continue with the strong mayor-type format, or should the mayor become a part-time position and then add a full-time city manager or city administrator? And what do you think about the idea of keeping a strong mayor but then adding an additional full-time administrative assistant to kind of provide more professional guidance and help?
Jay Kronenwetter, 90 seconds, then Bob Mielke.
Thank you. Well, I was adamantly opposed to the idea of replacing the mayor's office with an unelected city administrator. I believe it's imperative that the top level of our city leadership is devoted to the citizens, is devoted to the voters. And quite often, you know, you can look to our county government, you can look to other municipalities who have a city manager form of government. It can be very difficult and expensive to remove a hired manager, whereas it can be pretty quick and easy to vote a failed mayor out of office. So I would oppose replacing our elected leadership with a hired gun. That being said, and through the course of the campaign, I have been open to and suspect that we do need some more staff help in the mayor's office. Currently, the mayor has one assistant. Not too long ago, there were 3.5 FTEs in the mayor's office. That's a position and a half that's been eliminated. So it's quite possible that administrative help is needed. Hiring a formal city administrator, however, in addition to an elected mayor, I think would just be another way for our elected leadership to pass the buck and refuse to take responsibility for what happens on their watch. Already we have members of council and sometimes the mayor's office blaming city staff for problems in City Hall, and really the responsibility lies with the elected leadership.
Bob Mielke, you have 90 seconds.
Originally, I was a proponent of the city administrator simply because I thought our city was at that size and had the issues that was facing it, that we needed one. The people voted in a non-binding referendum that they did not want it, and we should be listening to what the voters have said they want. I am not in favor of a city administrator at this time. I am, however, in favor of possibly a chief of staff, somebody that would be helping out the mayor. It's been alluded to by Mr. Tipple that it's too much job for one individual. Whoever the next mayor is, they can make that determination, but I would also hold that staff person as far as a chief of staff, if you will, to be held accountable to the city council, and that person be tied to the mayor itself. If the mayor is voted out next time, that individual goes with them, and that way they can work hand in hand together to make sure that things work effectively together.
Sean Caldwell, you have a follow-up?
We talked a little bit about your leadership styles in terms of city government. Should it be run kind of like a private business, or do you think that running a city and representing all the citizens and kind of its competing interests kind of makes the business model something kind of questionable?
And this is an open discussion period of 3 to 5 minutes, whoever wants to go first.
Running City Hall is in fact running a corporation, so there are obvious similarities between running, say, a private business and running your city government. But other than the legal form of operation, you know, it's very dangerous to think that, operating City Hall like a business is a terribly productive mindset to be in. Ultimately, or ideally, City Hall is not trying to sell anything. You know, our City Hall, our city leadership to this point has been very enamored with the idea of marketing. You know, I hear them saying to get our economy going, what we need to do is we need to, you know, stay positive and brand the city well. And, you know, perhaps some of this run the city like a business mentality is getting, you know, far too much credence from the people in office right now. City Hall has responsibilities to its taxpayers. And 10 out of the last 11 years, our taxes have gone up in this city. And there's no real analogy there to the business world and tax rates. You know, these are not voluntary payments to us from customers. We are forcing our neighbors to give us their money. And when we do that, we have a responsibility to hold their interests in the highest regard. And I don't think that that has been the primary concern of City Hall for many years. And if I'm trusted as the next mayor, I'm going to be worried about the taxpayers of Wausau and the residents of Wausau and making their lives better and making sure that City Hall isn't making their lives harder. And those are going to be my focuses. Obviously, if I'm committed to bringing taxes down, I'm going to be looking for efficiencies. I'm going to be looking to save money, operations that corporate executives undertake all the time. But I'm very well aware that running a city government is very different from running a for-profit entity.
I would not want to run it per se as a business either. That's why you have department staff and department heads to be entrusted with that. Once again, though, it goes back to that sense of accountability. These folks have directives. They know what is expected of them to move the city forward. We work for the people of the city of Wausau. We work for the taxpayers, and there's got to be that accountability. Once again, not to micromanage folks, but to make sure that they know what the objectives are, and make sure that they follow through with them, and to make sure that things move forward.
And Nora Hurtle, you have the next question.
Can I ask a follow-up question on this one?
Sure.
Rob, you said that if we had a chief of staff, that person could go in or out with the mayor. Do you mean that the mayor would appoint that person?
No, if the mayor is voted out, that person goes with them. As far as in the next election, as far as accountability.
All right, now we're going to talk about Maine. The Village of Maine officials have said that they're trying to solve challenges with the indebted Village of Brokaw. They say that Wausau has thrown another wrench into the mix by suing Maine, and that was earlier in the year. Do you feel that the suit is worth Wausau's money and energy? And what would you say to frustrated Maine officials who say you shouldn't try to overturn a referendum that passed on a 5-1 vote?
And we have two 90-second responses. We start with Bob Mielke.
Well, first of all, I was fortunate enough to be chosen by my peers to represent the city of Wausau, and we reached out to the town of Maine, town of Texas, I'm sorry, it's the Village of Maine now, and Village of Brokaw to try to find solutions where we could all four work together to try to benefit. At this point, I'm not really wild about the lawsuit that's with the Village of Maine right now. Those residents, however, did try to annex to Wausau before the vote actually took place. And if they want to come with us, they should be allowed to, as far as for water or sewer or whatever reasons, property taxes. I still believe we should still work well together as far as extending the olive branch, as far as making things work. But I'm not really happy about that lawsuit. I don't think it really helps per se, but those folks did want to come with us beforehand, so that's the main reason why that lawsuit happened.
Jay, you've got 90 seconds.
Thank you. This is another example where my opponent has had the opportunity to address an issue, a serious issue, and things have simply gotten worse on his watch, not better. And he's not happy with the lawsuit. That lawsuit was the end result of his action and inaction to come to an amicable settlement with the town of Maine. In the long term, the problems facing Brokaw, Maine, Texas, they are Wausau problems. You know, we live in a regional economy. Many of our families stretch, from Brokaw to Wausau and beyond. We're facing these economic challenges together. If I'm trusted as the next mayor, however, in all of these discussions with surrounding municipalities, our taxpayers are going to be my primary focus. And I will not walk us into a circumstance where we are seeking to annex parcels for the benefit of, a few people at massive expense to the city and by creating a fight with a neighboring municipality. I think that's unwise and we shouldn't have gotten to that point. But municipal cooperation has been for 20 years or more one of the most important issues facing our city leadership, and I think it's another arena where change is demanded The current city leadership has had plenty of time to develop these positive relationships, and they have failed.
Nora, you've got a follow-up question.
Yeah, Village of Maine leaders say everyone, including leaders in Wausau, including those residents on the border, knew that they were going to try to incorporate months before the vote was taken in December. They point to a July meeting in which the city of Wausau, the city council, agreed to step back and let Maine, Texas, and Brokaw work out a common solution. Senator Jerry Petrowski got special legislation passed to expedite the town's transition into a village. So how is it possible that the action took Wausau officials by surprise?
This is an open discussion period. Bob, why don't you go first this time?
I don't know if it took folks by surprise. It goes back to, once again, you know, those residents wanted to come to Wausau, and they had voted to annex, if you will, beforehand, as far as trying to get into Wausau, as far as filing their all lawsuits and a petition to annex to come into Wausau. And I think that's the main reason why those residents, there was like 13 of them that wanted to come here. So that's the reason why we tried to get those folks here.
But wasn't there a five-month period between the time you knew that Maine was going to turn itself into a village? Was there an effort to approach those property owners and say, you know, the clock is ticking here. This is going to happen. If you want to do this, you better do it now. Did the city make an effort like that before you had to go to the steps of suing another municipality?
I don't believe so. Those folks wanted to come to us. And I don't know all the particulars, but they had wanted to come to us, and that's the reason why we went on their behalf.
I think my opponent has clearly answered. The city was not surprised, and they walked into this mess.
I've got one more question for both of you. Have either of you ever heard of an instance in which a vote to take a town and incorporate it into a village was overturned by a judge because of alleged open meetings violations? Has that ever happened before?
I think all of this regarding the town of Maine and the village of Maine, this is all in brand new territory. Brokaw, for example, cannot declare bankruptcy. That's just not on the books here in Wisconsin. This is all brand new, so I think we're learning as we go along.
Jay Kronenwetter, you're an attorney.
I can't think of, you know, a recent or near example that is quite congruent, but there are often fights over annexation and whether proper procedures, or excuse me, over incorporation and whether proper procedures were followed. The details of this specific circumstance with Brokaw, however, is, I mean, not only, this isn't just talking about the last July. The circumstances in Brokaw were clear to regional leaders for years, and it was obvious that Brokaw was going to run into a serious problem. And the second we knew that the mill was shutting down, you know, if we were concerned about our neighbors, the alarm bells should have been ringing and action should have been taken. And, you know, it simply wasn't.
Bob, do you have anything you want to add? Let's move on to Mark McPherson.
My next question actually has to do with something you mentioned, Jay, which is a regional economy. Wausau is an important economic center here in north central Wisconsin, but there's others, including Stevens Point, Marshfield, Wisconsin Rapids, Rhinelander, Minocqua, places like that. Do you think Wausau is competing with those communities for jobs and businesses, or do you think those communities, Wausau should be working with those communities to try to grow tourism, to try to encourage businesses to come here, or even start up in north central Wisconsin?
90 seconds for Jay and then 90 seconds for Bob.
Well, one reason why I am skeptical of our subsidized businesses first model of economic development is that it does, when we're simply looking to pay someone to locate in our city, that does create direct competition with surrounding municipalities. And that competition ultimately could be argued hurts the town who wins as much as it hurts the ones who lose. If we are seeking corporate partners who simply want the best deal from the municipality, you can be sure they're going to leave town as soon as they get a better deal. So in the end, we wind up paying quite a bit for perhaps a less than solid commitment to our town. You know, look at our current mall situation. I think we are being strong-armed, and CBL has played chicken with us at times because they have no real attachment to our community. So let's focus our economic development efforts on something other than simply subsidizing corporations who locate in Wausau. I think ultimately we need to be partners with surrounding municipalities because Wausau really is the economic engine of the North Woods. We are the launching point for tourism in many places in the North Woods. We are the industrial center of the North Woods, and we should be growing in concert with places like Rhinelander and others, and not in competition.
Bob Mielke, you have 90 seconds.
Wausau is such a crossroads, if you will. We're right in the middle of everything, and we are the county seat here in Marathon County, and we're the gateway to the north and so centrally located. You know, we should be working with our other communities. However, I'm going to try to get as many good-paying, well-paying jobs here into our area as opposed to the others, because my responsibility as mayor of Wausau is to take care of Wausau. Yes, I want to work with those other communities. We have to, because we're all neighbors together. But my responsibility is to try to attract as many well-paying, good-paying jobs here in our city as opposed to all the others. Doesn't mean I don't want to work with these other folks, tourism, whatever it might be. Because we are so centrally located, we should be concentrating here on Wausau first.
And Mark, you've got a follow-up.
In your opinion, what is our strongest industry here in Wausau? What are we known for? And is that something you want to grow as your time as mayor, or is it time to switch to another industry, another business, and try to grow from there? And along with that, is the proposed East Riverfront development a good use? Is that something we can grow as an industry, as a city?
And this is an open discussion period.
I think the riverfront is a good place to start. I'm not really happy with having to subsidize private entities and business. But you know, we've traditionally, be it paper or whatever in the past, it's time for a change. You know, information technology, the medical college is something that we really should be delving into. But manufacturing, in an aggressive sense, to go after those well-paying manufacturing jobs where an individual can support themselves and their family, and to build back that tax base here in Wausau. That's been kind of lacking, and I want our economic development and our community development committees to aggressively go after any type of business. Retail is nice, convenience stores are nice, but let's face it, they're not jobs that you can support a family on. But that's what I would end up doing. As far as going after the medical college, I wonder how come we don't have more food processing with all the water that we have all around here. There's a potential for growth for a lot of different industries. And Wausau, you know, we can do it.
I guess as a starting point, you know, it really isn't the mayor's job to decide what industries will locate in Wausau. And perhaps that's, you know, part of the problem we have with our current city leadership looking to subsidize and partner with private entities all the time is their primary economic development strategy. You know, the private sector, you know, the employers are the ones who determine what type of business they are going to open. You know, Wausau has seen a history. We started off as a forest products center, moved on to paper, moved on to insurance. And right now, healthcare is our leading industry as far as employment goes. And, you know, it just so happens that, you know, healthcare, as well as medical technology, information technology associated with healthcare, and durable medical supplies are growth industries. These are industries that nationally and internationally are experiencing overall growth. Perhaps those are industries we should be looking at fostering in the area rather than old line manufacturing work, perhaps. In the past, when we've tried to subsidize manufacturers, we get into sticky situations where, for example, we'll, you know, give $650,000 to Omotion to come to town, and that's a direct competitor to JARP, a local existing employer. And, you know, predictably, I suppose, JARP came to City Hall and asked for some money as well, and we've just provided some assistance in their expansion. But subsidizing specific manufacturers in the name of growing jobs can have unintended consequences, and we'd hate to be giving an outside corporation money simply so they can put a local multi-generational family business out of business.
So will business owners see, and this is for both of you, see you as a hands-on or hands-off mayor when it comes to helping growth?
Well, hands-on without a doubt.
Hands-on for me as well.
There was a question in Mark's question about the East Riverfront development. How do both of you feel about that?
Well, the East Riverfront development that has been moved forward thus far is troubling from a couple of respects. First, public enjoyment of the riverfront is really lacking in the current plan. And, you know, back when we passed a master plan for the riverfront redevelopment, you know, this was six years ago, I believe, public enjoyment of that riverfront was a primary goal. That was something that all the focus groups of local citizens said they wanted and demanded out of riverfront development. Now here we are with one of our last riverfront parcels that can be developed, and the plan they're pushing forward calls for privately owned buildings right up to the river edge. And no public approach to the riverfront that gives you the views. Really, it provides the enjoyment of the riverfront only for the residents of those buildings. And I would like to see that change before I would, you know, hand over free land or development assistance on the riverfront. I think the people spoke very clearly when we did our master planning, and, you know, their desires should be respected.
I would also say, too, that, you know, I'm not really completely pleased with this plan that's come forward. I think there needs to be more green space. I, too, also believe that it should be more public access, if you want to call it that. I do, however, think it's a good move as far as getting the riverfront developed. I see a lot of potential, a lot of exciting things happening there, and I think it's something that should be moved forward, but it's got to be tweaked. It's got to be done up a little bit differently, and we're still in the early stages for this, so.
And Sean Caldwell, you have the next question.
What has Wausau City government maybe been neglecting that you'd like to see more of a focus on? Is there anything that we should be paying more attention to now that we're kind of ignoring?
And Bob Mielke, you've got 90 seconds, and then Jay Kronenwetter.
Well, more than anything else, at times, I think things should be brought on, and it's been shown that I've already done this as far as things more done in an open and transparent manner. There needs to be that civility and that decency towards one another, and by and large, it is there. There should be more accountability, which I think has happened as well, but there needs to be more. And more than anything else, we should be answering to the residents of Wausau. They're the ones paying for everything. And I think at times in the previous leadership, that has not always been the case. There has not been an accountability. And it's been troublesome in the sense that at times, you know, you feel like you're inside a cave, and as far as trying to get things brought forward, you know, you feel a little stifled. Now, it's easy for somebody on the outside looking in and say, well, you could change that. And that's not necessarily the case. Things at times are more difficult than what you might think as far as getting things out there where everybody knows what's going on. But that's something that we need to get back to as far as an accountability back to the taxpayers of the city of Wausau. That would be one of my biggest things.
Jay, you've got 90 seconds.
Thank you. Poverty. Without a doubt, the biggest problem that has been completely ignored by our city hall is poverty in Wausau. And this has been a growing problem for at least half a decade, and city hall has done next to nothing to address it. In 2009, about 16% of the kids in this town, 16.5%, were living in poverty. In 2014, the last year we have data for, 32% of our children are growing up in poverty. It's a third of our kids, and we are completely ignoring the reality of their lives. And you can ignore it for so long, but, you know, children who grow up poor use drugs more often, commit crime more often. And this becomes a problem that affects all of us in the long run, not just the poor. To address poverty, you have to address childcare, affordable childcare. In Wausau, it's about 60% more expensive than the national average to get quality childcare for your kids. You need to address transportation. That's a big piece that City Hall has failed on in the past 5 years as well. And then finally, living wage jobs, not subsidizing retail sector jobs.
And Sean, you've got a follow-up question?
Specifically, kind of maybe going along with poverty, how about the issue of diversity? Has the city of Wausau been neglecting that as we've seen the rise of Black Lives Matter, even gay pride parades, and other issues of domestic violence by Hmong leaders? Should the city of Wausau be doing more to integrate minority populations to the greater community?
And this is an open discussion period.
I would say that Wausau has been trying to diversify. You know, sometimes change is hard for some folks to adhere to. And I look at, say, the police department, for example, and we have diversified. We do have Hmong officers. We have African-American officer. You know, it just takes some time to get things done. I kind of wanted to get back to something that Jay had said before, though. You know, as far as the poverty rate for children, this is not just something exclusive to Wausau. This is a national trend. And, you know, talking about transportation, you know, Wausau is not getting the money, and neither is any city in the state, for that matter, as far as our shared revenue. We're not getting money like we used to. So the state budgets are getting tougher and tougher to try to address all these different issues. But I would also go back, you know, a lot of these programs that he's talked about, while well-intentioned and noble, you know, some of these are already in place by the federal and the state government. For the city government, truthfully, we just don't have the money. It's a cold way of putting it, but it's just not happening. But as far as getting back to your original question with diversity, I think the city is slowly doing that and trying to include others. I know we're trying.
Can I respond to a point here?
Absolutely, it's an open discussion period.
This idea that the city doesn't have the money has been repeated over and over again. But folks, the money is there, they're just wasting it. Okay, they're spending it on the wrong priorities. We've just been discussing $4 million spent to renovate a Yonkers, and he tells us we don't have money for the poor children in our neighborhoods. This city council just borrowed $20 million last week. $20 million, and we don't have money to address poverty? It's just a lie, plain and simple. The money is there, it is being spent on different priorities. Now, as far as this being a national problem, yes, poverty exists all over the world. But compare Wausau's circumstances for single mothers. These are mothers with children under the age of 5 in their household. 76% of them in Wausau live in poverty. 76% of single mother head of household homes are in poverty. Compare that to Milwaukee, Wisconsin, the city of Milwaukee. Their rate is 55%. Okay? We have 50% higher childhood poverty rates than Milwaukee, Wisconsin. That is not a national issue. This is the reality in our city because of the priorities that City Council has set. I believe our residents are ready for a change in priorities, and that is why I'm running for mayor.
Can I ask where you're getting those numbers from?
That is the American Community Survey.
Anything else on this topic?
Let's move on. Just for people who don't know, those are the numbers created by the Census Bureau.
We have three questions left, and we're running out of time, so we're going to do a format change. I discussed this with the candidates ahead of time. And we're going to ask the three questions, and then we're going to give each of the candidates, we'll give each 90 seconds to respond without the open discussion period. So Nora, you go first.
As leader of the city, will you rely more on constituent feedback or your own moral compass?
And Jay Kronenwetter, you have 90 seconds, and then Bob Mielke.
Well, on issues where I'm facing a moral conundrum, I will rely on my moral compass. On most issues of city policy, I think I've made it very clear that I want to involve the citizens of Wausau more directly in decision-making. I think very shortly after I take office, you will find the city's website providing you with open records that you can search and look up without having to go down to City Hall and ask a clerk and then, you know, answer a bunch of questions about precisely what you're looking for. We have the technology to put this info out there, and we'll start doing it. I want an open, inclusive attitude in City Hall where all of you will feel welcome to come on down, express your viewpoint, and trust that your city leaders are listening and not calmly waiting for you to give up the microphone. That is my intention. But certain issues, you know, you brought up diversity. And, you know, obviously sometimes city leaders are put in situations where they have to make moral decisions, where perhaps you have a lynch mob mentality in your town. You know, the majority at any given time is looking to get something done, but that something would abuse the rights of one of your residents. Well, I intend on being the type of guy who will stand up to usurious or abusive public attitudes. But I expect the people will be in charge on most policy measures.
Bob Mielke, constituent feedback or your own moral compass?
It would be both, actually. I mean, city input, the residents, they're the ones that hire us. Obviously, you folks are the ones that should have that right to expect what they want from us. That's why we are there. And to do it in an open and transparent manner more than anything else. And I think that's already been shown as far as what I have tried to do. And that's what I would continue doing, is listening to the residents.
Mark McPherson, you've got the next question.
My question is about renewable energy. Would you support something like installing solar panels on city buildings? And would it just be a statement of support for renewable energy, or would this make economic sense for the city?
And we'll start with Bob Mielke and then Jay Kronenwetter.
Definitely. I think that's something, anything we can do as far as saving money and saving the environment. Solar panel has proven that it works. I'm all for it. I think it's an excellent idea. That was brought up by Pat Peckham, who I see out there. I think it's an excellent idea and something that we should pursue.
And Jay Kronenwetter?
Absolutely. I think diversifying our electric grid in many different ways should be on the city's radar. One area that I had looked at was waste management. And we have this recurring problem of waste management contracts and landfills. And then what do we do with our landfills? Well, you know, creating electricity from trash, you know, that's something that they're doing in Europe quite well, with lower emissions than our coal-burning power plants. And it sort of kills two birds with one stone. And that is something that when our next waste management contract is coming up in about 4 years, I hope to have the groundwork laid on exploring options for alternative energy sources in waste management as well. But, Pat definitely had the right idea there with the solar panels and City Hall, any municipal buildings, mind you, and I would like to explore our opportunities for assisting homeowners and local businesses in developing some solar power on their sites as well. You know, maybe instead of loaning $4 million to CBL with no idea of how they're ever going to pay it back, we could have been looking at loaning that money to homeowners so they could lower their electric bills. You know, I'm a believer in sustainable economic development. And that means taking a long-term view and looking toward future growth industries, not old manufacturing industries. So renewable energy is one area you'll see a strong focus out of City Hall in.
And Sean Caldwell, you have our final question.
Kind of going off of that, what are some of the things on your short list that you'd like to accomplish in the next 4 years, or even just your number one priority upon taking office?
And it's Jay Kronenwetter, 90 seconds, then Bob Mielke.
Well, my number one priority, as I've said before and I'll say it again, is to return decision-making authority to the people. And that's going to take a long time. It's not going to be flicking a switch. But I would expect very shortly after taking office, you can start seeing that change in City Hall. And that culture change will allow our wonderful staff, our city leaders, to get things done for once. And maybe avoid your taxes being raised next year because, we couldn't come up with any alternative, you know? It's just the way it's been going for 10 out of the last 11 years, so, shucks, it's budget time again. Guess we have to raise those taxes. You're gonna see proactive leadership with your concerns at the forefront. That'll be a big change.
Bob Mielke?
You know, our city needs to create more positive outcomes, and slowly but surely, it will happen. You know, Mayor, who promotes Wausau and manages City Hall well, and the staff involved, and once again, going back to those expectations and that accountability, we've got a wonderful, caring, very professional staff. And sometimes it bothers me that they get unfairly beaten up, if you want to call it that, because they are trying, and they're very professional. I, too, will be a proactive mayor. I've already shown that I've gotten involved. You know, get to get involved with our business leaders and our neighborhood groups and our community leaders and reach out to them and looking for their expectations, but especially our business leaders to find out, you know, what can we do to bring better jobs here, to make a better quality of life for folks. I think it goes back to that as far as getting involved, a hands-on approach, trying to do things before there's a crisis type of situation, which seems to have been happening in the past.
And this brings us to tonight's closing statements. As determined by our coin toss, Jay Kronenwetter will go first, Robert Mielke will go second, and you each have 1 minute.
Thank you. Thanks again for all your attention this evening coming down. It's a very important election that we're facing here, and we have an opportunity to change directions. You know, for the first time in over a decade, a real opportunity to change the priorities in City Hall. And over the course of the campaign, I think I've come to find that my neighbors want this change, and they demand this change. And I don't have experience on city council, and I know that's something that maybe some folks are troubled by, concerned as to whether I can, you know, hit the ground running, if you will. But I would note that I first ran for mayor some 18 years ago. Before any of the men who stood against me this time were involved in local politics. I was raised in a household that valued our community, our neighbors, over all else. And that matters. And over the entire course of my adult life, I have been preparing for this job through nonprofit management, through my legal career, and by staying closely in tune with what's going on in my community and in City Hall. So I'm ready to hit the ground running for you if you trust me on April 5th.
And Bob Mielke, you have a closing statement.
Well, first of all, thank you all for having us here to speak tonight, and thank you to all of you for coming out to listen to us tonight. You know, I'm not one to make empty promises, but I do promise this. In my administration, there will be no toleration of scandals or conflicts of interest or questions about integrity. I will not be waiting for issues to be facing us to become a crisis before having them addressed. And there will be positive changes at City Hall. There has to be, in an open and transparent manner. You will not find a bigger cheerleader, a better ambassador for the city of Wausau. I truly love our community, and I do care about the people here. That's been shown. And as I said earlier, I want our city to succeed and move forward in a positive, progressive type of way. I will bring the city council, the mayor's office, city staff, and the residents together. I've already started that process. I think that's already been shown. I want a strong spirit of community. I want everyone to be proud that they live here in Wausau, that they're from Wausau, and that we live in the best city in Wisconsin, the best city in the nation. You know, and as president of the city council, I've gathered and garnered valuable experience in the operation of the city. I understand the complexities of the leadership of a large organization. I understand that a positive working environment is essential to a well-run city. Experience does count. And, you know, like I said before, our city is at a crossroads. And with your help, I really do think I could lead in a positive way. And therefore, I'm asking for your vote next Tuesday.
And that concludes tonight's combined media debate. For the candidates for mayor for the city of Wausau, thanks to our candidates, Attorney Jay Kronenwetter and City Council President Robert Mielke. And a round of applause, please, for our panelists, Nora Hurdle of USA Today, Network Wisconsin, and the Wausau Daily Herald, Mark McPherson of WAOW-TV, Newsline 9, and Sean Caldwell of WSAW-TV, News Channel 7. A special thanks to the staff at UW-Marathon County, Dean Keith Montgomery, Theater Manager Chris Berg, and Rick Ryer and Jane Ritger of Wisconsin Public Radio. I'm Glen Moberg. You've got a great audience. Don't forget to vote Tuesday, April 5th. Good night, everybody. Thank you.